Copies of the order of service on the table at the back.
Thank you.
Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we know that you are here with us. Help us to confess our sins, to sing your praises, to join in prayer, and to hear your word to us through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. We're living in a time of a few restrictions at the moment. One is that we have to put a mask, that's very exact, and another is that we're not allowed to even sing in church, but we can listen to hymns. I've chosen this morning a hymn that reminds us of God's ongoing love and care towards us. Great is thy faithfulness. Sadly, although I have 17 CDs of hymns, I have a single one with this hymn sung on it. So if you find a copy, let me know. But we can listen to the tune as we reflect on the words that are printed on our sheet. So let's listen again. Great is thy faithfulness, who art my Father. so let us confess our sins to Almighty God, saying together, Almighty Father, our Heavenly Father, we have sinned against you and against our brethren, in thought and word and deed, through negligence, through weakness, through our failure to God. We are truly sorry and repent for all our sins. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, who died for us, forgive us all his past, and grant that we may serve you in newness of life, for the glory of your name. Amen. Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, with his great mercy, has promised to forgive us of sins for all those who in heartfelt repentance and true faith turn to him. Have mercy upon each one of us, pardon and deliver us from all our sins, confirm and strengthen us in all goodness, and bring us to everlasting life. Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Our reading this morning is from Matthew's Gospel, chapter 22, as printed in our service sheet, which we're all going to read out aloud together. Then the Pharisees went out, and they plans to trap him as his words. They sent their disciples to him, along with their Herodians. Teacher, they said, we know that you are a man of integrity, and that you teach the way of God in accordance with the truth. You are swaying by others, because we pay no attention to who they are. Tell us then, what is your opinion? Is it right to pay all the tax to Caesar or not? But Jesus, knowing their evil intent, said, you hypocrites, why are you trying to trap me? Show me the coin used for paying the tax. They brought him the denarius. And he asked them, whose image is this? And whose inscription? Caesar's, they replied. Then he said to them, so give back to Caesar what is Caesar's, and to God of his gods. When they heard this, they were amazed, took their head and went to bed. And to do is reflect on those words again, you might have keep that sheet in front of you, but so it's a joy, delight to discover that this coming week, 22nd, sees the wonderful anniversary of John and Jean Smith. Jean's here this morning. Your diamond wedding anniversary. That's 6 years of our love. We want to celebrate that together. So, if I come to you, we're going to give for you, and perhaps everyone else can give a massive round of applause. Lord, you promised in your word and lead to us a light to our path, a lamp to our feet. We pray that you would open up our eyes to see your wonderful light shining and give us grace to learn and to respond to what you teach people there say. Amen. Well, we turn to our reading today, headed in our versions of this account of paying the poll tax to Caesar. At the beginning of the story, a man came to church and asked to see the vicar. And he said, Vicar, I'm very sad to say my dog has died and I would love to have a Christian burial for him. He said, well, sorry to hear that, Lord God, but honestly, it's like we don't really do funerals at the hospital. You might try the Baptist church or the Pentecostal church down the road, they might be able to help. And then we're saying, I'm sorry, we can't help, but I do understand, I'll try the Baptist church. Yes, Lenny, would you tell me how much it would be appropriate to give the Baptist church as a memorial if they do the funeral? I want to mark this occasion. I was thinking of a gift for £10,000 might be appropriate. Do you think that's enough? Hang on, said Peter. Did you say your God was Church in England? At first blush, you might think that our reading this morning is just another story of religious leaders making a very great claim. Pharisees coming to Jesus to ask how they could extort more of a tax for themselves rather than sending off to the Romans or something like that. But in fact, it's not. It is a question about money, but it was a question posed to Jesus as something of a cudgel, something of a way of getting at him, which the religious leaders thought might press forward their tax on him. Teacher, they said, verse 16. And notice how they try to buffer these up. We know that you are a man of integrity, and that you teach the way of God in accordance with truth. You aren't swayed by others, because you pay no attention to who they are. So tell us, what is your opinion? Is it right to pay the tax, poll tax, to Caesar, or not? Well, basically, that's quite a simple question. But actually, it's quite a lot of salt, don't we, behind it. Firstly, if you look at the two groups of people in verse 2 who have come to Jesus, no, not verse 2, where are we? Verse 15 and 16. Look at the two groups, they're the Pharisees and the Herodians. The subtlety of this has been rather lost on us, I'm sure, down the generations. Unfortunately, we probably struggled to work out who they were. But if we look at it, you discover that they have precious little in common. These two groups actually would barely pass the time of day with each other, given the chance. Politically, and in almost every other way, they were poles apart. The Pharisees were the nationalist party among the Jews. Intensely patriotic, they were sworn enemies of Romans, and they vigorously opposed Roman rule. They deeply resented the paying of taxes to Caesar, the mask of their religious sympathies. The Herodians, on the other hand, were the party of King Herod, who had made a deal with the Romans to retain limited power in the region. They were the wealthy and privileged class who gladly collaborated with the enemy, helping them rule the Jews in exchange for status and power in their day. And they survived this dynasty only by the grace and goodwill of the Roman Empire. So they would have no problems in paying taxes to Caesar at all. But what we have is a kind of mixed group coming together to try and get at Jesus. Someone once said, my enemy is my friend. That explains these two groups. The enemies of Rome and friends of Rome united in their opposition to Jesus himself. So they put this question to him, is it right to pay imperial tax, this poll tax, for Caesar or not? At first glance, it looks quite innocent in that question, couched that it is, and such great flattery in it. And it's not something about all the people's opinion. It's interesting, isn't it? Tell us what you think. And if you ask me today, if we try to pay council tax or not, it would be a fairly big problem for me to answer that without revealing my own political views. If you sin, yes, the trouble is he would have offended the Pharisees. If he said no, he would have the Herodians on his back and perhaps the Roman authorities themselves. If you look at the background of this tax, it's actually labeled sin in our versions of poll tax. Well, I think some of us might recall what the introduction of poll tax did in the 80s. Well, this was a first century poll tax. The tax payable directly to Caesar. It was one denarius, which was a day's wage. So not insubstantial. But all the debt taxes of the day, this particular tax, was problematic for the Jews. Because it was a tax that was required to be paid in Roman currency. And the Roman coins all bore on their brass coin, but one tiny brass coin on here, you can't even see it. It's a tiny one, but on the front of it is a picture of Caesar himself, as many staunch Jews might say, a graven image of Caesar. And on the inscription, he also describes him as a son of God. So, in effect, contravening the first of the Ten Commandments. So, in general daily use, special cover, of course, where the British instead is without those features, so there was no problem. But when it came to pay this particular tax, it had to be paid in this particular coin. And as I say, if Jesus was put on the spot, he had a dilemma, because if he said yes, he would be in trouble for the Jews, who found this particular question. And this is opportunity, more important, to reaching out to many of his contemporaries. He wanted to be able to speak to them about it, can't even want to set an offender for all reasons. Yet he said, no, we should not pay Caesar anything. The Romans could have a charge of treason, effectively, undermining the government, at least. And they would have no problem swaying the prince to take Jesus out of circulation, which is the goal of both parties. So what did he say? Well, his answer. He didn't avoid the question. He answered it straight, and in doing so, not only avoided the dilemma in which his speakers were trying to push him, but also some important principles for us of abiding value. He indicated at heart that a Christian disciple is in fact a citizen of two worlds, that he has obligations both to his earthly and his heavenly government. It also says that there's no necessary conflict of loyalty between the duty to our world's leaders and our duty to God himself, which is also significant looking at the pages of history. So let's take the region term. First of all, citizens of earth. It's a translation. Jesus asked for a coin, but not just any coin. He asked for one of these coins that was used to pay the tax with some fish in his pocket and found under the eyes. And immediately, he held it up and realizing that paying with this coin would have caused a certain amount of concern among sort of more conscientious Jews, he had enough of them and said, well, whose image is this on the coin? And of course, they were not Caesar's. This is verse 29. And then he would ask them, so, verse 21, give back to Caesar what is Caesar's, and to God what is God's. And it's a great answer to the stroke of genius, really. So much so it says that none of the questioners wanted to coax more out of him after that, verse 22. What he was doing, you see, with this response, was reminding his hearers that as subjects of Rome, they were debtors to Rome. And the question was about, is it right to give to Caesar this tax, as if it was some sort of free gift on their part, undeserved by them? But Jesus reminds the people who are paying the tax that they are under obligation to pay for what they receive. We still think that they're bows and aqueducts, the law and all that they take, and those were things that were a benefit to the society Jesus. They had great transport ministry, an aqueduct that provided water to Jerusalem, and the army and every order throughout the kingdom. All this is cost money and were a benefit to society. And if you notice in Jesus' answer, you might miss it actually from the NIV because it doesn't use quite the same words. The rest was, shall we pay taxes to Caesar? But you could translate, shall we give taxes to Caesar? And Jesus' answer in verse 24 says, you can give back to Caesar what is Caesar and to God what is God's. What Jesus is saying is that the tribute to Caesar is not an offering of a gift, it's a discharge of their debt. beginning back what you've already seen in terms of services. But at heart, Jesus is clearly teaching that the believer has a duty to respect, and that we must recognize the lawfulness of earthly government in some respect. And what it says is that there's no necessary reason why a person could not be a good Christian as well as a good citizen. Caesar has his place in temporal matters. But that's not all he says, is it? He also reminds them that they're citizens of hell, too. So he says, give back to Caesar what is Caesar's, yes, but also carries on, and to God what is God's. What's he saying? Well, clearly he's making an important distinction. There's one obedience which a Christian owes to secular government, his laws, protection, and gift. But there's another obedience which believers owe to God, who's created and within us. And he's putting them back on the spot. Because he's reminding them, you can be a great citizen, but completely ignore your debt to God. Now, when push comes to shove, there's no question as to who the primary loyalty is due. In any crisis, when there's an apparent conflict of duty, the Christian knows at once that a choice has to be made, and we know that God comes first. You go to the Apostle Peter in Acts chapter 5, verse 29, said, we must obey God rather than human beings. And Apostle Paul talking in Philippians chapter 3 about our true citizenship in heaven. Those things are true. But you've got to hold them in balance, in a sense, as Jesus encourages us to do with his words that we read today. So what conclusions do we draw from this? Well, I suppose the challenge of appearance to say is not such a hot potato in our Western society as it was in this day. It does remain a huge dilemma in some countries where states, certain business states and certain communist states, persecute Christians and demand their religious allegiance away from Christ. But in the West by and large, we all enjoy the benefit that the state brings. What would we do without electricity, without roads and air and running water? Clean water, come to that. As a consequence, we can, as Christians, by and large, be good citizens in a secular society, providing that what society says to us doesn't contradict our commitment to Christ. Then maybe you'll want to that is an issue. We can't just take things for granted and become complacent, but at present, that doesn't appear to be the case. We could give back to Caesar what is Caesar's. But also, we need to recognize the challenge of the second part of what he says, and to God what is God's. When he says our ultimate loyalty lies with Jesus and our Heavenly Father first and foremost. When I was younger, the church used to teach through a process of what they called catechism, where there were various bits you learned off by rote, as it were. And was the question, what is our duty to God? And the answer was this: my duty towards God is to believe in him, to fear him, and to love him with all my heart, with all my mind, with all my soul, and with all my strength. To worship him, to give him thanks, to put my whole trust in him, to call upon him, to honor his holy name and his word, and to serve him truly all the days of my life. Quite a mouthful to try and remember as a young child. But that's quite a challenge for us, isn't it? It's not a God who bumps into us once a week on a Sunday morning when we have to prevent him. It's a God who is in complete control of every part of our lives. And that's perhaps something to ponder and reflect upon over this coming week. How does my life measure up to those sort of challenges? What do I need to do practically to change so that I can follow this pattern? Think a little bit more about that as we come to our end of the meeting and look back and look forward at what God has been and will be amongst us. But just a final note, bringing us back to Jesus. We can probably only understand what Jesus was doing in this incident, when we see his answer in the light of his whole story. You see, Jesus knew, he already told his disciples that he himself was going to be crucified by the authorities. And when he was put on the spot by this question, he wasn't afraid of being tricked by the Jewish authorities into a position that might lead him on a path to death. He wasn't trying to get out of or wriggle away from opposition where it might be required. We even know from historical sources that when he was a boy, death by crucifixion had been the fate of some of his fellow Jews under the leadership of a man known as Judas. And that group had rebelled on precisely the issue of Pentecostes. The Romans had crushed the rebellion mercilessly. And they did so, leaving the countryside around Judea strewn with people hung up on crosses and dying on missions there as a warning to people. So, what I'm saying is, when asked about Pentecostes, Jesus wasn't by his clever question trying to wriggle out of personal or political danger. He knew danger. And he's actually still continuing to walk straight towards it. He was on his way to Jerusalem. But what he was trying to do was get these two disparate groups who come to him to rethink their attitude towards society and towards God. One was given hope towards society, this sort of rebellion, they were on the others were given, so they thought, to God and laughing at the Pharisees. Neither got the balance right. Both were ignoring key principles of the heart of godliness. Well, Jesus was going to eventually walk the path that would take him to the cross outside Jerusalem, but he was going to do so on his own terms. And his vocation was not to be the sort of revolutionary people who had seen up to this point, refusing to make actions and inspiring some sort of popular rebellion. True, the kingdom of God would soon defeat the kingdom of Caesar, but not by conventional means. Rather, it began by the victory of God's love and power on that cross at first Easter. A victory that was not just the authorities of our own earthly rule, but the great empires of sin and death themselves. It would come when Jesus willingly laid down his life on the cross and rose triumphant over sin and death. And that is where Matthew's gospel, which of course means good news, is leading. And don't just get caught up in whether you should be paying taxes today. The key is, who are you truly following? Are you following just what rules are laid down by God? What is what Jesus wants us? Worship and trust in God, which goes way beyond sin, and offers so much more. True forgiveness of our sins, a real relationship with the living God, a heart forgiven, and a promised eternal future with Him. That's what's the same in behind these sort of questions that were posed to Jesus thousands of years ago. Challenged in the way all of us live. And the way our true focus and attention is given. Let's pray. And God, a simple question we pay taxes, but the Lord is not, and yet great things at heart. Help us to stop and reflect where our main focus might be at the moment. Who we follow, what we follow, what matters to us, what do we give back to our society, what do we give back to you? What's more significant, what we hold back from you, as if it were our own instead of a great generous gift from you in the first place? Lord, teach us to have a proper understanding of the various things that we truly know to you and to our society, even yourself.
We pray this morning for all who are adversely affected, especially those who caught the virus and are receiving hospital treatment. We pray for the medical staff who treat them. May they have all the PPE protection that they need, as well as appropriate staffing levels, and the drugs and medication required to treat their patients and protect themselves. We pray for those working in research for a vaccine, that they find and are allowed the opportunity to share the results of their endeavours with the worldwide scientific community. We pray for those responsible at every level for the test and trace program, and that those required to self-isolation might do so with a willing heart and an acceptance that what they do is the common good. Lord, in your mercy.
Amen.
Lord, this is a challenging time for those in positions of leadership, whether they be our elected politicians, deputy level, entrusted with the task of taking and implementing decisions on our behalf, or whether they be leaders in the world of business or science. Difficult decisions must be made by them. We pray that they may have the wisdom and discernment and open mind to the advice that they might receive, and as true will seek for the common good rather than seeking a personal or political advantage or adhering to their previously held views, policies, and perceptions. Lord, in your mercy.
Father, the imposition of new restrictions in lockdown in the last part of our nation has been anxiety, stress, and suffering. We pray for those who have lost or might lose their jobs, whose businesses are on the brink of collapse or are failing today. Give to them courage and the energy. Give them the determination to build their craft, whether in search of new employment, opportunities to start a business, or in trade and change the world. Give their spirits, Lord, and may they find hope in what's fairness in our hopeless situation. Lord, in your mercy.
Instructions for our patients and policy and what they need in the case of school and Sheffield, which is a very different aspect of the use of COVID-19 changes. We pray to our children to be safe and well and to be engaged with their learning. We pray for their teachers and all who are in hospitals are and around the country. They can manage any changes for us and for them. Often at short notice, and that they will have support and direction as they are needed. Lord, in your mercy.
Accept these prayers for the sake of your Son.
answers our doors. So we say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us today our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. 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 To close with another hymn. It's one of my favourites, I have to say, and it's Guide Me, O Great Redeemer. One of the things that we tend to lose sight of when something global like this happens, or something national like this happens, is the thought that God remains sovereign, that He's in control. We don't think that we run out of control. But here we are, looking to the great Savior, Redeemer, as it means. And the sovereign God, who has not just all of this life in His hands, but our eternal future in His hands as well. And that's what shines through this hymn, and is effectively the basis for a prayer for the past times, for the future. So let's listen again to Guide Me, O Thou Great Redeemer.
Thank you.
close with words of the Holy Collect, which you'll find in our service sheets. Let's join together in prayer once more. Almighty and everlasting Father, we thank you that you have brought us safely to the beginning of this day. Keep us from falling into sin or running into danger. Order us in all our ways, and guide us to always what is right in your eyes. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Let's pray for one another to receive God's grace. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all evermore. Amen. So may the peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God and His Son Jesus Christ our Lord. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be with you now and forevermore.